morning, everyone. Service will begin in just a few short minutes, but I wanted to show you what you have done for our community and for children who are in food insecurity. I have Pastor Jeff and Connie Rushing with me from City of Hope Athens. Pastor Jeff, tell us a little bit about what these bags are going to do for families.
These bags are going to help children have something to eat throughout, not just a weekend, but some of these bags are going out throughout the week to help children. Before COVID-19, we were serving about 52 weekend food bags a week, and right now we are bumping 300 a week. A lot of children are very hungry, and these bags are going to make sure that children have something to eat. And we thank you for your generosity and your love and your care for us to make sure that the people in Athens, Clark County are fed.
Amen. Thank you, Grace Fellowship. Thank you for your generosity and for loving your neighbor.
Hey, good morning. We are so glad you're here. We're going to start by lifting our hearts up to the Lord in worship right where you're at, no matter what you're doing. We encourage you, hey, sing with us. We got a new song we're going to sing called You Keep Hope Alive. It's about that God is our only hope, a source of all hope. And so it goes like this.
You keep hope alive. You keep hope alive from the beginning to end. Your word never fails. You keep hope alive because you are alive. Jesus, you are alive.
Okay, you got it. Try it now. Here we go.
And you keep hope alive. You keep hope alive from the beginning to end. Your word never fails. You keep hope. You are alive, Jesus, you are alive.
Yeah, he's our hope. He's our hope. In every time of trouble, yeah. Some days may be darkest, but your light is greater. You light our way, God, you light our way. When evil is rising, you're rising higher with power to save, with power to save. Say it now, you keep hope alive.
You keep hope alive. You keep hope alive from the beginning to end. Your word never fails. You keep hope alive because you are alive. Jesus, you are alive.
Death had a strong hold. Your life was stronger. With power to save.
And you keep hope alive. You keep hope alive from the beginning to end. No word never fails. You keep hope alive because you are alive. Jesus, you are alive.
morning there's hope in the evening. Hope because you're living. Hope because you're breathing. There's hope in the breaking. And hope in the sorrow. Hope for this moment, my hope for tomorrow. There's hope.
Wow, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Grace Fellowship. My name is Tony Vismore. I serve as the lead pastor. And what a delight it is to welcome you to our online service yet again here at Grace Fellowship. Listen, I know we wish we could be together. We can't yet do that, but we're closer today than we've ever been. It won't be that long. But today is a special day. It's a day that the Lord has made, and the Bible says we should rejoice and be glad in it. This is the gathering of the people of God. Listen, I know it's so easy to think about what we don't have. I'm reminded of the words of the Apostle Paul in Philippians chapter 1, when he said to that group of believers, I long to be with you. You know, he could have focused on being separated from them, but rather Paul said, there's something that's special that happens because we are the people of God. The Holy Spirit of the living God is moving. Even though we're distant from one another, He is moving in all of our hearts, in all of our lives, and in all of our stories, making us one in the Father. Today is a day of celebration. Listen, don't just sit there this morning. We want you to participate. I know you're in your jammies and you're drinking your coffee, but why don't turn your living room into a sanctuary? This morning, stand and clap and sing along with us. Lift up your voice in prayer. And I believe God's going to do something remarkable. I believe hope is going to come in to your story. We're so thankful that you're here. Allow this to be a time that the presence of God moves in your home as powerfully it is moving with Jason and the team. Listen, I want to pray for you as we begin that this will not be a television show, but this will be a day where we encounter the Almighty God. Would you pray with me this morning? Go ahead and stand to your feet. Why don't we do that? Stand to your feet and let's pray. And let's ask God to do something significant in our life today. Father, we thank you for this is the day that you have made. We will rejoice in you because you are the God of hope. You are the God who is able to turn around our circumstances and bring forth good. I lift up every person that is watching. Those who everything is going relatively well, and even those who it feels like everything is going wrong. Lord, speak to their heart today. Strengthen them today. Encourage them today. Let hope arise in them today so that when we dismiss in a little while, we will all say, it's been good to be in the presence of God today. We thank you for it. We believe you for it. Now come on, church. Say amen with me, and let's worship the Lord our God with all of our hearts today. God bless you.
How is the hallelujah? The presence of my enemies, I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. A hallelujah. for me.
I'm gonna sing. Darkness flee, yeah, and I'll raise a hallelujah, yeah. In the middle of mystery, yeah, and I'll raise a hallelujah, when heaven comes to fight for me, yeah, and I'm gonna sing. Thank you.
This is how
And this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. And this is how. There's no one like you, Lord.
The word says if the Lord is for us, if you are for us, who can stand against us? Too many times we confess, Lord, that we approach our life and our problems. We approach them with our own power. And we confess, Lord, right now that we turn our eyes to you and we remember that the battle belongs to you. In you, Lord, the battle is already won. In you, Lord, we have found victory. In you, Lord, we see the end and we know, Lord, that we've already become victors. We're made in your image. So, Lord, we commit ourselves once more to walking in obedience, to walking in surrender, to walking in your victory. We pass through the doorways of obedience and surrender. We walk into the room of victory that we find we're in your presence. We find we're more like you. This is how we fight our battles, calling on the name of Jesus. Call on you, Lord. You're more than enough. We found you to be more than enough, Lord. Have your way today. In your name, everybody, wherever you're at, in your name, say amen. Amen. Amen.
How do we define a hero?
Superpowers and a mask. Ooh, a cape. Oh, wait. No cape. Capes are dangerous.
No.
Okay, then a cool name, like Master Defender or The Ultimate Vindicator.
I think we're off track here.
Really? You said a hero.
I'm talking about a real person, not a superhero out of a comic book.
Maybe someone with unusual strength?
No, but...
Or someone who has no fear no matter what comes his way.
Not quite. But I think you're getting warmer.
So, what is a hero?
I think a hero is one who loves.
What? Like roses and kisses and hugs?
Seriously? I think you've been watching a few too many movies during quarantine. I'm talking about real love.
Real love?
Yes. Think about it. Love protects. It hopes. Love perseveres. It puts others before itself, and it doesn't delight in evil.
Love protects.
Exactly. Regardless of how scary the situation is, a hero defends people anyway. Why is that?
Courage?
Courage, compelled by love.
But what if the person doesn't deserve protection?
Love protects and hopes anyway without keeping a record of wrong.
But what if the person isn't grateful for that protection?
Love is not self-seeking. True heroes don't serve for what they get in return.
But wouldn't heroes get discouraged?
They can, but love hopes and always perseveres.
What if those being protected never even know the cost?
Again, love seeks the good of others above its own. Love sacrifices.
What if the cost is high? Really high?
No one has greater love than this, that one lays down his life for his friends.
But can a hero really... Well, risk it all?
Yeah, they can. These heroes are people just like everyone else. They're imperfect. They deal with fear and discouragement, and they get it wrong sometimes.
Like me.
But regardless, they've chosen to love in an extraordinary way. Without even realizing it, these human heroes have demonstrated a spiritual truth.
Sacrificial love?
Exactly. Romans 5:8 says, "But God demonstrates his own love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Unlike human heroes, Jesus, God's Son, was absolutely perfect and blameless. And he laid down his life for us so that we could be free from sin and its penalty and enslavement. But then he did that something that no hero, no matter how amazing he or she is, can do on their own. He rose from the grave to reign for eternity and to intercede for us. He rescued us.
I want all the human heroes to know what God has done for them.
Me too.
And I wish I could say thank you to each and every one.
So do I. For now, though, we can remember those who sacrifice. We can thank God for them.
And we can pray for those still serving. So, while heroes may not wear a cape, sometimes they may wear a uniform.
Sometimes.
I've always thought of a hero as someone who's well-known.
They can be, but often they dutifully serve, unknown, unrecognized. But today, we honor those serving on the front lines of this pandemic, COVID-19, and take a moment to say,
Thank you.
'Cause when no one else would care, you did. And when no one else was there, you were. Now I am so aware, you're a blessing to me. What did I do to deserve? To deserve you. There's no words that could describe, that could describe how much I thank you.
What a fantastic morning of worship. Thank you, Jason and team. And again, we just can't say thank you enough to our tech team and all those that are working so hard to bring these services to you. If you get a chance, shoot them a big thank you on social media. Send them a DM on their website or on their Facebook. I know they would appreciate it. Well, this morning, Trish and I had plans to be with Pastor Rich Bowen in the New Hope Church in Augusta. Pastor Bowen was scheduled to retire after 55 years of full-time vocational ministry. We were so excited about being able to celebrate that day with him. Because of COVID-19, they've had to readjust that. Well, being gone, I had invited Pastor Adam Shin to come and share the message with you. And it takes a lot to write a sermon and prepare a sermon. And I just felt like I didn't want to take that away from him, even though my plans changed. Adam has been with us for 8 years. He started as our youth pastor, and now he is the director of our broadcast media. And it is such a delight for him to come this morning and share the message of the Lord with you. So would you put your hands together and do it so loud he can hear you all the way here in Watkinsville? And would you welcome Pastor Adam Shin this morning to share the Word of God with you?
Thank you, Pastor Tony. Thank you to the worship team. Thank you. I'll give you your checks later. Appreciate all the applause. 8 years. It's crazy to think that Sue and I and Nevada and Dakota rolled into town from Wichita, Kansas 8 years ago. Montana wasn't even a part of our family at that time. Think about this. The sixth and seventh graders that were here at our church then are now finishing their freshman and sophomore years of college. Yeah, it's crazy to think about how old I actually am. If you want to look, pause your screen and count the gray hairs on my head, go ahead. But while you're doing that, let me tell you a little something that we have on our online platform that maybe you're not aware of. At any moment of the service, during the countdown, during the worship aspect, during the announcements, during the message, if you need prayer, on the right-hand portion of your screen, the lower right-hand portion of your screen, there is a live prayer tab. If you click it, and it will open up to a private chat room for you and an online host. Give the online host just one moment to get to your private chat room, and they will want to pray with and for you. Our world is going through some crazy times, as everybody knows. And there are some crazy decisions that have to be made in government levels, whether it be national levels, state levels, and local levels, and even on our church level. Pastor Tony and the Elder Board are facing some critical decisions about how is Grace Fellowship going to open up in the near future and how it's going to look. So for all 1,500 of us that call Grace Fellowship home and that we love our church, Anytime you think about Grace Fellowship or you're praying for Grace Fellowship, pray for Pastor Tony and the Elder Board for wisdom in how to open our church back up. So let's take just a moment before the message starts and let's pray together. Heavenly Father, you said in your word that if two or three are gathered in your name, you are there in the midst of them. And we know that even online, you are here in the midst of us. So we need you now, Lord. Lord, be with our pastor and the elder board of this church that you established so many years ago. They have a lot of critical decisions that need to be made in the coming weeks and months, and they need your guidance. This outbreak of COVID-19 did not take you by surprise, Lord. So guide them. Let them hear from you and follow your plan. In the name of Jesus, the strong Son of God, amen. So what I need you to do this morning is I need you to take your Bibles out. Maybe they got some pages in them. Come on, somebody, as some preachers say, that didn't feel right. I'm going to scratch that. So moving on. Or maybe you have the digital kind. Get the digital kind out as well and turn to Acts chapter 1 and Luke chapter 19. And as you're turning, I want to ask a question that we're all asking. What do we do now? I think we ask this question every day, and every day it changes. Let me take you back to a gathering on top of a mountain and a decision in a what do we do now moment. And that decision changed the world. So if you have your scriptures ready in Acts chapter 1, verses 9 and 10. After saying this, Jesus, who was talking to his disciples on top of the mountain 40 days after he was resurrected, he was taken up into a cloud while they were watching, and they could no longer see him. And as they strained to see him, I love that phrase, as they strained to see him, the Message Bible says it like this. They stood there staring into an empty sky. The Greek term, which I am not going to pronounce, means looking intently. It's there at the bottom portion of your screen right now. It is used 14 times in the New Testament. So I want you to imagine this. I want you to imagine you're the disciples. You've been with Jesus for 3.5 years. You've loved this man. You've followed him everywhere. He has been your world for 3.5 years. You've ate with him. You've traveled with him. You slept in the same room with him. He was everything. Then he was killed. Then, just a couple days later, you see him again alive. And for 40 days, you're hanging out with Jesus off and on. And now you're sitting on top of a mountain and you're staring up into an empty sky because now he's gone. And the disciples are sitting there like, okay, what now? Maybe if it was you and you'd be like, okay, Peter, what now? What do we do? John, you got any clue? I don't know what to do. And some angels had to basically wake them up from their stupor, and it reminded them what Jesus had just said to them a verse earlier in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. I love how the Living Bible says it. It says, you will receive power to testify about me with great effect. It was the disciples' job to get down off the mountain and tell those that didn't know about Jesus about him. They were supposed to connect the people that didn't know Jesus to Jesus. They were supposed to build a bridge to Jesus. And that was their job, to build the bridge to Jesus. And our job is the same. We have to build somebody's bridge to Jesus that doesn't know him. This crazy pandemic time, a bridge can be built because people are searching. My favorite city on earth is New York City. For those of you that know me, That is not a surprise. I've been so many times, I've lost count. I've been to missions trips. I've been on vacations with my wife. I've been to conferences in New York. People want to retire and move somewhere hot, like Florida, Arizona. I want to retire and move to New York. My wife won't let me, but I want to retire and move to New York City. One of the most famous bridges in all the world is in New York, and I've walked across it a couple of times with our students on the missions trips. It's the Brooklyn Bridge, and it connects Manhattan and Brooklyn. And it took 14 years for them to build this suspension bridge. And it was completed in May of 1883. And when it opened, not many people wanted to use the Brooklyn Bridge because it was a unique technology, and it was the longest suspension bridge in the world. Let's face it, it freaked people out. They thought it was going to collapse because it could not hold the weight of all those people. And a year later, in May of 1884, they hired P.T. Barnum, the famous circus showman, to walk 21 full-grown African elephants across the Brooklyn Bridge back and forth to show people that it could hold the weight, to show people that it was sturdy enough to hold the horse and the buggy and all the foot traffic. Last week, Pastor Tony told a story about Benjamin Franklin going to France and hearing the great preacher George Whitefield. And after the service, somebody asked Benjamin Franklin, "Do you believe that stuff?" And Benjamin Franklin said, "You know what? I don't believe it, but I know George Whitefield believes it." Can that same thing be said about me? Can that same thing be said about you? I don't believe it, but Adam Shin sure does know he believes it. We have to reflect Jesus. We have to know who he is. We need to give people the reason that we can have hope, love, joy, peace in the middle of a pandemic is because of Jesus. People have lost their jobs. They've lost their businesses. They are searching for certainty. The government can't give it. The CDC can't give it, but only Jesus can give it. Can I be honest for just a moment? I stress about money a little bit. My wife and I own two daycares and preschools in Snellville and in Lawrenceville. And I stress out about the profit and loss margins all the time. And I look at it every day. I come to the church and then I go home and I stare at a computer screen for a couple hours just looking about how much money we're making or losing. And I freak out about it sometimes. But can I tell you something? Over the past 6 or 7 weeks, when our revenue has come down to a grinding halt, like many of you business owners, I haven't stressed one time about money. And if you know me, you know that's a miracle of the Lord. And the only thing that I can point my finger to is Jesus. That he has given me certainty because he is certain. He's my rock. And then I have to think to myself, I have to take me out of it for a few minutes. And like, for what about those people that I know that maybe own a business that don't have a relationship with Jesus, that they're freaking out right now? Can I be that bridge? Because Jesus is my certainty. Who he was and who he is gives me certainty that we're going to be fine. We're going to be okay. Our business may never rebound. But Jesus is my rock. And Jesus is your rock. Who he is and who he was is certain. And he'll never change. You remember 9/11? How many people flocked back to the church? I know our church in Florida was packed for weeks and months. You remember how fast that faded? This is an unprecedented time for us as a church because people are searching for certainty. They are searching for solid ground, and we have it. But can we reflect it? Can we build the bridge to connect those that don't have a relationship with Jesus to Jesus? Can we show them that the bridge is sturdy enough to walk on? To walk across. And here's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to be a little interactive. I'm going to ask you a question, and you can answer it now, or you can answer it after the service. But the question is simple. Jesus is blank. And I want you to take it to your social media, every person in your family, and answer that question. Jesus is blank. And use the hashtag Jesus is and the hashtag GraceAtHome20. Take a picture of you and your family and put it on Facebook and answer the question. Take a picture, put it on Instagram. If you still have a Twitter, put it on Twitter. But let's answer that question and let's blow up the internet this morning with the answer of Jesus is blank. So I'm going to give you a couple of mine this morning, if you don't mind. And they're both found in Luke chapter 19, the story of a wee little man named Zacchaeus. So let's open up the scriptures to Luke chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. And let's start with verse 1. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus, and he was the chief tax collector. And he was wealthy. So my first blank is this. Jesus is a friend of sinners. Have you ever made this statement or heard this statement? If God can save blank, he can save anyone. Well, that's this guy. This is Zacchaeus. He was a modern day mafia member. He was a Jewish mafia member. He worked for Rome, betrayed his own people, charged his own people taxes, an arm and a leg, then paid Rome what they wanted, and he always overcharged his own people, and he kept the surplus. He gave Rome what they wanted, then they paid him a salary probably, so he was the wealthiest man in Jericho. He probably lived a lavish lifestyle, had the best house, had the entourage of people, dressed in the finest of robes. He had the nicest chains. He looked good. But he was short, so he had a short man's complex. So he was probably charging people more because of that. He was a bad guy. Nobody in town liked him. Now, he wanted to see Jesus. And because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him. And Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus spotted him, he looked up and he said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must go to your house today." So at once he came down and welcomed him gladly. Can you imagine being Zacchaeus? You're up in that tree. And Jesus says, "Zacchaeus, yo, come down." And he's like, "Whoa, how'd this guy know my name?" "Oh, he's heard of me. He's heard that I'm the man around here. He wants to have lunch with me." But you see, climbing that tree did not get God's attention, did not get Jesus' attention. It was Jesus' mercy for a sinner named Zacchaeus that got Jesus' attention. And all the people saw this, and they began to mutter, "He has gone to be a guest of a sinner." You know what's the problem with the phrase, "If God can save blank, he can save anybody"? It makes the person saying that seem better than the person that they're talking about. Like their sin is worse than ours. But if you ask the Apostle Paul that, he would totally disagree with you, because in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15, in the Message version, it says, "Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. I am proof. Public sinner number one of someone who could never have made it apart from sheer mercy." The Apostle Paul stopped at himself, saying, "If Jesus can save me, he can save anybody. Because I'm the chief sinner." See, when Zacchaeus had Jesus over for dinner, it created a scandal. Scandal is a late Latin word that's derived from the word scandaleum. And it means this, a stumbling block. It doesn't make sense or an offense. This ticked people off because in that culture, eating with someone was to identify with them. And Jesus was a good man, so making friends of a guy like Zacchaeus, who was a punk, didn't make sense. It was scandalous. Preaching at them, rebuking them, criticizing them, mocking them, openly making fun of them, that was the norm. That was applauded to ridicule the bad people in town. But sitting around a table, telling jokes, and enjoying life together, that was shocking. The rules said that Jesus shouldn't be hanging out with a man like Zacchaeus. If we put it in today's terms, Jesus was hanging out with today's pimps, prostitutes, drug dealers, and mafia members. Jesus associated himself with people who were shunned by every single upstanding Jew. They were the butt of jokes. They were the target of smirks. And no self-respecting Jew would risk befriending them for fear of being guilty by association of bad people. And Judah Smith says this. He goes, Jesus made it a point of seeking out sinners and befriending them. He wasn't concerned about his reputation. Notorious sinners didn't kill Jesus. Religious people did. If Jesus were alive today, this is what I think. Just me. I think every time the church doors opened, Jesus would be here at church with someone new. Or if he was living right now, he'd have so many digital invites to all his sinner friends that he'd be blowing up everybody's mailbox. And he'd have people watching online all the time. And during the week, if he could, if it wasn't under quarantine, he'd be hanging out with the people who we've been told all our lives that we shouldn't hang out with. Why? Because Jesus is a friend of sinners, the ones that we look down on, like Annie. Annie, all she wanted was love from her father. So he was in the home, but he was an absentee dad. He did not show any affection towards his young daughter. And so Annie, she started partying. She was very attractive. So you know what she did? She was already sleeping with guys. She started charging for it. She was prostituting as a teenager in high school. Then when she became of age, she started stripping. Then she met a guy. She fell in love with him. He became her pimp. Then they moved to Las Vegas. She became a high-end prostitute, making over $10,000 a night. $10,000 a night. But to cover the pain of that lifestyle of being a prostitute and being raped almost all every night, she started getting addicted to cocaine. And one night, as she was intentionally ODing herself, she felt like she was starting to die, and she realized that she didn't want to die. And she screamed out, "Jesus, save me, please." And Jesus didn't get off his throne and go, "You know what, Annie? I need you to stop being a prostitute first. Annie, I need you to stop doing drugs." He's like, "I want to save her. I died for her. She can be saved because of me." And Jesus saved her. And now Annie runs a ministry in Las Vegas, getting prostitutes off the street and turning them to Jesus. You know why? Because Jesus is a friend of sinners. Annie is Zacchaeus. Annie is me. And the good news is that Jesus came to reveal a God who defines us not for our actions, but defines us by his love and his grace. The word grace in the Webster Dictionary is defined as unmerited divine assistance given to humans. Unmerited means undeserved. deserved. Have you ever walked into your kid's room and it looks like this? How many of you can say that you can give grace all the time? It looks horrible. You have to spend hours cleaning it. Or maybe you're editing a video that has to get up for the online service and you're sitting at your computer. You're editing away. You have a deadline to make. And your six-year-old is playing in your living room and all of a sudden you hear a bang. And you look over and your six-year-old has gone as white as a ghost. And you look at him and you're like, what happened? And then your wife goes, oh no. And you look at your TV and it looks like this. There's no way Montana could pay me back for my TV. Just like there's no way for Zacchaeus to pay for his sins. There's no way Annie could pay for her sins. There's no way Adam Shin can pay for his sins. There's no way you can pay for your sins. And you know what? Jesus doesn't care. Because he's a friend of sinners. That means he's a friend of you and me, and he wants to give us grace. We don't know what was said at all in that meeting, that party. But this is what happened at the end of it. But Zacchaeus stood up and he said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. Right now, he's already starting to liquidate his accounts. He's already starting to get cash so he can give to the poor. Right now, he's selling off everything in just one afternoon with Jesus. And if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay it back four times the amount. He's gone broke. He has gone absolutely broke. Because one afternoon, one encounter with Jesus makes you want to start to change your life. Guys, when you meet that love of your life and that your wife or guys, the guy, the gal that you're dating right now, if she doesn't like something about you, you change it. Am I right? Sue dresses me. I have to get my clothes approved by her when we go out. And you know what she always says? You wearing that? Really? Really? You wearing that? So you know what I have to do? I have to go change. This is the honest, the goodness truth. This is my second recording of this message. You know why? Because I forgot to get my wardrobe approved by my wife. So guess what? Take two. But it doesn't work. It doesn't work both ways. Sue had this shirt that I absolutely hated, but she wore it all the time, and it drove me insane. I tried to hide it. She'd find it. She would always wear that thing, and I don't know why I hated it so much, but it drove me insane. And you know what? She didn't care. She wore it. It didn't go both ways. But you know what? Jesus accepts us for who we are. And he loves us for who we are. Because as the relationship grows with Christ, we start to change. When we meet grace and we understand what Jesus has done for us, it becomes the fuel of our faith. We pray. We read our scriptures. We worship. We try to live the life that we tried the best that we possibly can. Because you know why? Because we are in love with Jesus Christ. And our relationship with him should trump everything. And that right there is what happened to Zacchaeus. That's why he changed. He went broke. And you know another reason why he went broke? Because Jesus is enough. Jesus is enough. During my last semester as student pastor here, I got a text message from a parent says, my child is searching. They're trying to make sense of this life and Jesus for themselves. How can I help? And you know what I realized right at that moment? That we're all searching because we are in need. No matter how old we are, we're searching for more. And why do we seek more? Is because we were all created in the image of God. And we have a God-shaped hole in our heart that He fills, and He can alone fill. How many of you have seen your kids and you look at them and you go, that's me? What they just did reminds me of me. Montana, a few months ago, he was sitting in my chair watching TV, and he made this confused little face, and I went, oh my goodness, that's me. That's me in a nutshell. And we all do that, because if we don't have a relationship with our Creator, that God-shaped hole never gets filled. And we're going to try everything in our natural power to fill that hole. And we'll do anything. And we have to connect people to the God that they're searching for. They may not even realize they're searching for it, but we have to connect them. Here's some interesting statistics that I heard this past week. Alcohol sales from this point last year to right now is up over 240%. The Tinder dating app, where you have an app on your phone and you have a picture and you either like the person, so you swipe one way, or you dislike the person and you swipe the other way, and you can contact all the people that you like. In one day, that app had over 3 billion swipes, because people are searching. The porn industry right now is giving away free memberships. The top websites are just giving them away. Hopefully you've gotten your stimulus check. But you can't spend it on anything fun. Sue and I haven't been out on a date in about 6 or 7 weeks. Well, I take that back. We did go on a date just the other day. We went to racetrack. We walked to racetrack, got a drink, got an ice cream, and just hung out together. But that was the extent of the date, a 2-mile walk. People are searching. And the door is wide open for the church. Wide open. If you've ever seen the movie The Greatest Showman, it is loosely based on the life of P.T. Barnum. And in the movie, it started out with him just wanting more. He wanted to provide a good life for him and his family, something better than he had as a child. And he achieved that. But once he had that, he wanted more. Nothing satisfied the hunger. He wanted more, he wanted more, he wanted more, he wanted more, and more did not satisfy him. He almost lost everything because of wanting more. And there's a song in the movie called Never Enough, and I want to play about 30 seconds of that song.
All the shine of 1,000 spotlights, all the stars we steal from night sky will never be enough, never be enough. Towers of gold are still too little. These hands could hold the world, but it'll never be enough, never be enough for me.
We need to show people that are hesitant to walk on the bridge that Jesus is enough, that Jesus is all you need, that He can hold the weight of your life and your issues. Jesus is enough. Somebody right now needs to know, somebody right now is depending on your reflection of Jesus Christ. Come on, that's good. I'm going to repeat that again. It's just me in Nevada and a bunch of empty chairs in here, but I know that's good. Somebody you know is depending on your reflection of Jesus Christ and how you answer the question, Jesus is. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Are we that reflection of Him? Are we connecting someone that doesn't know Jesus to the God that loves them, that died for them? Are we that connection? Are we that bridge? Are we connecting them with love so Jesus can love them and then He can correct? The church doesn't need to correct. The church just needs to connect. And it's time for us to answer that question. The band is going to answer. They're going to answer that question in a song in just a minute. But Jesus is blank. With the hashtag Jesus is and Grace at Home 20. Let's let all of social media know who Jesus is. Let's be honest. Somebody right now needs Jesus. You don't have a relationship with Christ. Answer that question now. Jesus is. I don't care that you don't have a relationship with him. But answer that question. Then this is what I want you to do. I want you to go down there and click the live prayer tab and so we can have a host tell you who Jesus is. Because life will bring you to your knees. And boy, has it in the past month and a half. But you know what the answer? The answer still is Jesus. It's always been Jesus. It will never not be Jesus. It will never stop being the power of Jesus. His blood is sufficient for your salvation, for my salvation. Jesus will get us through every challenge, every heartache, every trial, every temptation. He will never leave you, nor will he forsake you. Because I know this, and this, I need the camera really tight right here. Jesus is the King of Kings. Jesus is the Lord of Lords. Jesus is El Shaddai. Jesus is the Alpha. Jesus is the Omega. Jesus is the beginning. Jesus is the end. Jesus is true happiness. Jesus is calm. Jesus is certain. Jesus is unchanging. Jesus is my rock. Jesus is my provider. Jesus is joy. Jesus is hope. Jesus is peace. Jesus is love. Jesus is a friend of sinners. And Jesus is enough.
There's hope in the morning, hope in the evening, hope because you're living, hope because you're breathing. There's hope in the breaking, hope in the sorrow, hope in this moment, my hope for tomorrow. There's hope in the morning, there's hope. Because you're living, there's hope. Because you're breathing, there's hope. In the morning, there's hope. In the sorrow, there's hope. In this moment, my hope for tomorrow. You keep hope alive. You keep hope alive. From the beginning to end, your word never ends. Beginning to end, your word never fails you. You keep hope alive because you are alive. Jesus, you are alive.
Wow, what an amazing day. Thank you, Pastor Adam, for that message. Jesus is enough. He is enough in every situation of our life. Now listen, as you leave and you go through your week, you think on that, meditate on that, and I'm telling you, the Lord will encourage you. Now, before I offer the benediction, just a couple of quick announcements. First of all, I want to say again, thank you for being such a generous people. During COVID-19, this church, Grace Fellowship, you have been so generous, and we're so appreciative of that. I want you to continue to worship, if you will, this morning through giving, if you haven't already. If you'll notice on our website at graceathens.com, there's a give button and you can give digitally. If you're not comfortable doing that, then you can mail it in. Our mailing address is on the website as well. Also, in just a couple of weeks, it's Mother's Day. We're going to have an amazing celebration celebrating our moms. We have some special things planned on that day. So we're going to ask dads to take a picture of mom and the kids and send them in. We'll be giving you all sort of information on our social media feed, so be watching that. But you can send those photos to info@graceathens.com. We'll give you a lot of information on that. Again, thank you so much for being with us today. We pray that today will be a day of strength and blessing as you go from this place. Now the benediction. With my hands towards yours and you towards mine. Until we meet again, my friend, may the God of all hope fill you with hope. May you know that he is a God who is more than enough. May he go before you and follow up after you. May he bless you in your rising and your sitting, your going and coming out. And may everything your hands find to do May they be blessed as you hearken unto the voice of the Lord our God, the God of hope. God bless you, everyone. Have a great week in the Lord. We'll see you soon.